So good morning and welcome to worship. I was saying we're a little bit bigger crowd this morning. In the summertime, it tends to go up and down depending on people's vacation plans. But whether you're here in person or whether you're watching the video later online, it is always great to be together to share in prayer and praise. If you are here in person and are able to stay afterwards, it is lovely and cool downstairs in the basement here, and there are refreshments on. I saw cake. So please feel free to join us for a time of conversation and catching up. We'll continue with our summer worship schedule for one more week. So next Sunday, we will be here, joint Trinity Atwood service at 10 a.m. And then on the Sunday after that, at the beginning of September, we are at 9:30 again here in Atwood, and then 11 o'clock at Trinity. At that point, we will resume live streaming in real time. So there'll be a live stream of the 11 o'clock service, which you can also watch later on YouTube if you prefer. Many thanks to everyone who helped make our Vacation Bible School Activity Day at the Atwood Pavilion such a success this week. We had 17 children participate, and it was a lively and fun morning. So thanks. Most of the people who helped are not here, but thanks, Diane. And we celebrate that that took place this week. We will be wrapping up what we've called VBS Remix with an outdoor movie night on Friday at the Atwood Presbyterian Church, outside in the parking lot if the weather permits, inside if it doesn't. Please join us at dusk, which is about 8:15 now, for the movie Fly Away. This is a free event and everyone is invited, so bring your lawn chairs or a blanket and consider joining us for that. With fall fast approaching, we also have some meetings coming up in the life and work of the church. The Joint Worship Committee meets this Wednesday at 7 p.m. here in Atwood. Please speak to any Worship Committee member if you have suggestions or ideas for fall. The Joint Christian Education Committee meets next Thursday, September 1st at 7 p.m. at Trinity. So please speak to any CE person if you have thoughts about fall. And there will also be a meeting around coordinating and planning for pastoral care for fall at Trinity at 1 p.m. on Friday, September 2nd. And anyone from the Trinity community who is interested in pastoral care is also welcome to attend and share ideas at that meeting. Similarly, with fall being just a few weeks away, there might be information that some of you want to get out in terms of announcements or news to share with the church communities. The September newsletter for both churches, deadline for both churches, is next Sunday, August 28th. So please share material for Atwood with Angie or for Trinity with Donna. Or if you'd like it in both newsletters, please send it to both Angie and Donna. There are some additional announcements about events happening in the wider church as well as in the community in your announcement sheet. We are continuing to produce those this fall for each church. And if you have announcements that you want on this sheet, which at Trinity is also emailed out on Thursday mornings, please make sure that they are in to Angie or Donna or both by 9 a.m. on Thursdays each week. Now let's take a moment to breathe deeply together and to center our thoughts on God as we gather for worship. As we gather, we acknowledge that this land on which we are meeting is covered by Treaty 29, or the Huron Tract, signed between the Crown and certain Anishinaabe groups on July 10, 1827. We affirm that as current inhabitants of this land, we are parties to this treaty and responsible to ensure that its terms are justly fulfilled. As treaty people, we recommit ourselves to the work of truth and reconciliation, and offer thanks for the land on which we live and work and worship. As we light this candle, may our loving God kindle the flame of the Spirit in our hearts, that we might live courageously in the way of the liberating Christ, today and always. Amen. join me in our call to worship, which is is selected verses from Psalm 71. In you, O God, I have taken refuge. Because you are my sheltering cliff, my escape from pursuit. You are my hopefulness, my upholder, my light, the one who taught me trust from my youth. Let my mouth flood over with worship. All day long I will speak of your beauty. I will remember your faithfulness, more powerful than anything else that exists. Let us pray. Mothering God, we rejoice that you placed us in the womb and called us forth. We rejoice in knowing that our steps are guided by you and you are reliable. We delight ourselves in your presence and give thanks as you deliver us from fear and let your love have its way in us. Embolden us to speak your truth to power and to let the power of your truth always be evident in us. Amen. And we'll sing 644 in your hymn books if you want the music, or it'll be on the screen. For the time we turn away from your plans for us. For the times when we let greed or jealousy, scorn or spite guide our actions. For our resistance to forgiveness, generosity and mercy. For our reluctance to love deeply with our whole hearts. Let us open our hearts now to the abundant grace of God. God knows everything about us. God knows us better than we know ourselves. And God loves us. Let God's forgiveness and mercy sink deeply into your soul so that your living may be renewed by healing love that overflows to touch the lives of all those around you. Thanks be to God. Stories this morning. Jeremiah says he's only a child, or sometimes it's translated, I'm only a boy, or I'm just too young. And God says that isn't an obstacle to helping with God's work. So I want us to brainstorm this morning, what are some of the things that children can do to help God's work?
Be themselves.
Be themselves?
Interact with older people, they love it.
Interact with older people, yeah, they can bring a lot of joy. What else do kids contribute? Some of you must have kids in your lives.
Happiness.
Happiness, yep. There's an enthusiasm, I think, about kids that reminds us that life is meant to be pursued even. Right? Like the ant is fascinating, and where is it going, and what is it doing, or the butterfly, or the bird, or the sunshine, that everything is filled with possibilities.
Noise.
They can be loud. Yes, kids don't tend to be kind of conscribed and confined, right? They live life big in lots of cases.
I was recently at an event. I had more fun watching them than they had playing in the water. So they made my day.
They made your day, absolutely. Okay then, in another part of the Bible, Sarah and Abraham tell God that they are too old to participate in God's work. So we're going to brainstorm again. What are some of the things that seniors can do to help in God's work?
Visit.
Teach them old games.
Drive them to appointments.
Drive people to appointments, absolutely. Mentor younger people.
Grandparent.
Grandparent. Yes, I once had somebody say that everybody should have someone that when they walk into the room, their face lights up. And I think that's often a grandparent. It doesn't have to be a biological grandparent, but I think that seniors often have that gift to contribute, the just absolute joy at seeing children being themselves or other people being themselves. Okay, how about the people in between? So what the first hymn we sung refers to as not too old, no longer young. What can they do to help with God's work?
Lead.
So kind of be a bridging, yep.
I think it's largely this group to do the work of the church.
Do the work of the church.
We have to rely on that middle group.
Yep.
To do the
So we're going to listen to this morning's scripture, and I invite you to be attentive to the ways in which you might be being invited to participate in God's work. Our first scripture passage is from Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 to 10. God said, "Jeremiah, I am your creator, and before you were born, I chose you to speak for me to the nations." I replied, "I'm not a good speaker, God, and I'm too young." "Don't say you're too young," God answered. "If I tell you to go and speak to someone, then go. And when I tell you what to say, don't leave a word out. I promise to be with you and keep you safe, so don't be afraid." God reached out and touched my mouth and said, "I'm giving you the words to say, and I am sending you with authority to speak to the nations for me. You will tell them of doom and destruction, and of rising and rebuilding again." And then from Luke's Gospel, chapter 13, verses 10 to 17. Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. A woman was there who had been disabled by a spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and couldn't stand up straight. When he saw her, Jesus called her to him and said, "Woman, you are set free from your sickness." He placed his hands on her and she straightened up at once and praised God. The synagogue leader, angry that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, responded, "There are 6 days during which work is permitted. Come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath day." Jesus replied, "Hypocrites! Don't each of you on the Sabbath untie your ox or donkey from its stall and lead it on to get a drink? Then isn't it necessary for this woman, a daughter of Abraham, bound by Satan for 18 long years, be set free from her bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said these things, all his opponents were put to shame, but all those in the crowd rejoiced at all the extraordinary things he was doing. May God bless to us these readings from our sacred scripture. And we're going to listen to a piece of music by Linnea Good, who highlights some of the ways in which we all feel unqualified in some of the Bible stories. Thank you.
was a bum. Sarah was to senior Jeremiah was to him. Rahab was a prostitute, Jonah didn't care. Elijah was a whiner, David killed for a affair. St. Paul was to release, and his disciples failed and fled. Martha toiled and Mary's toiled, and Lazarus was dead. So we're way off. When life sinks through your heartless way, God doesn't check our resume, but leads us in and guides us to the things that Christ would do. The cross is but the meeting place, two intersecting lines of grace, where your passion joins the hunger of this world. So don't be intimidated, don't let anything stop you from taking that first step. Moses, he was no speaker. And Jacob, come on, he was a bum. Sarah, that's nice. Here's someone else. We'll do it. Dear Jeremiah, don't even think about it. Rahab, Jonah didn't care. Elijah was a whiner. David did for a little bear. St. Paul was to religious. His disciples failed and fled.
For many years on the internet, various versions of a No Excuses Sunday list have circulated. And here's one I came across again this week. To make it possible for everyone to attend church this Sunday, there will be a special No Excuse Sunday. Cots will be placed in the foyer for those who say Sunday is my only day to sleep in. We will have steel helmets for those who say the roof would cave in if I ever went to church. Blankets will be provided for those who think the church is too cold, and fans will be provided for those who think the church is too hot. We will have hearing aids for those who say the preacher speaks too softly, and cotton for those who say that the preacher speaks too loudly. Scorecards will be available for those who wish to count the number of hypocrites present. Some relatives will be in attendance for those who like to go visiting their family on Sunday. There will be TV dinners for those who can't go to church because they have to cook lunch. One section will be devoted to trees and grass for those who like to see God in nature. Finally, the sanctuary will be decorated with both Christmas poinsettias and Easter lilies for those who have never seen the church without them. Obviously, you folks are here. So you are the ones who didn't make excuses this Sunday. And if you're listening later on YouTube, that counts as making time for church in my books, too. Furthermore, I'm also not interested in guilt or shame as motivators for coming to church. There really are reasons sometimes why it makes more sense for folks to be elsewhere on a Sunday morning. But what this list highlights in a humorous fashion is our human ability to let excuses get in the way of doing things that we know will contribute to our well-being or the well-being of others. In our Hebrew scripture story this morning, God says to Jeremiah, Jeremiah, I am your creator, and before you were born, I chose you to speak for me to the nations. In response to which, Jeremiah makes two excuses. I'm not a good enough speaker, and I'm too young. And there's actually no reason to doubt the validity of his excuses. We don't know if Jeremiah was afraid of public speaking, as many people are, or if he found it difficult to put words together into a convincing speech, also a challenge for many folks. But it is reasonable to assume that one or both of these concerns were on his mind when he said, I don't have the way with words, God. And we also know from the length of his ministry as dated by the rulers and historical events which he refers to throughout the book of Jeremiah, that Jeremiah preached for at least 65 years. So if he retired or died when he was in his 80s, which would be a very old man in the ancient Middle East, then he couldn't have been older than 20 when God spoke to him. And some have suggested he might have been much younger, perhaps still a teenager, or even, say, 13. By comparison, Moses is estimated to have been about 40 when God calls to him from the burning bush, and Jesus was likely 30 when he was baptized by John in the River Jordan. So Jeremiah was quite a bit younger than most of those called by God to big things. So what Jeremiah says about his limitations is quite probably true. But God still chooses him to offer words of doom and destruction, rising and rebuilding again to the nations. And God promises to equip him with the words and the courage he needs to share God's message in the world. And it's a big job that's before Jeremiah, a difficult one too. Jeremiah will be beaten, imprisoned, ridiculed. At one point he's thrown in a pit where he sinks in the mud. Jeremiah is often referred to, in fact, as the weeping prophet because he weeps so often when his message goes unheeded. There are definitely a lot of challenges ahead for the prophet Jeremiah. But in this moment, as his prophetic journey begins, God promises to be with him and to keep him safe throughout it all. And as the song that Linnea Good that we listened to before the sermon so humorously reminds us, this is a common dynamic in Scripture. Those that God calls often feel underqualified or ill-suited for the task. They're too young, too old, not a good enough speaker, have complicated family situations, simply don't want the job, and much more. Yet like Jeremiah, God still calls them, even though they make excuses about why God should definitely pick someone else. In fact, God often calls unlikely people to key roles in sharing God's good news with the world. And God can be mighty persistent when the person being called is reluctant. Perhaps you've experienced a similar dynamic in your life. God calls. You make excuses why not to respond. God persists. And eventually you answer the call. I've been reading a charming novel called Iona Iverson's Rules for Commuting. It's the story of a diverse group of people who met on a commuter train. Over the course of several months, we see their lives unfold, and many of them face this kind of choice moment. How do you deal with middle age? What if the job you have now is really not the vocation you are called to? What should you do if your romantic relationship is falling apart? Are there times when that relationship should fall apart? How do you deal with people who treat you badly? How do you cope with grief and loss? Is it okay to let other people know that you're not okay? And initially, almost all of the characters resist the changes that are happening in their lives. One person even lies to their family and friends for months about having lost their job. And people go out of the way to avoid each other so they won't have to confront their feelings or talk about what's going on. The diversity of the storylines is a reminder that these same dynamics play out for many of us at different points in our lives around different issues. I would love to give you the details of even just one of the storylines, but that would ruin the book, and I want to recommend the book to you. Besides, I really want to invite us to think about our own lives and how God might be calling us today. So let's begin. If it helps you to be introspective, feel free to close your eyes. No one is going to ask you for your answers to these questions, so be honest with yourself as you listen for the whisperings of the Holy Spirit. If your reflections do evoke something you would like to talk more about, please reach out so we can chat about that. I'm always delighted to talk with folks about what arises on their faith journey. So take a few deep breaths as we take a few minutes to listen for God together in our own lives. As you listen for your own soul wisdom, is there some aspect of your life where you might be feeling a call from God? What are the questions that keep coming up for you? What do you wonder about at 3 a.m. or when you're sitting out in nature watching the birds? Is there something you keep saying no thank you to, but yet cannot seem to let go of? Do you have a dream that you are feeling blocked in pursuing? Is there a challenging choice or potential change beckoning in your life right now? Take a few moments to pay attention to any stirrings that may be happening in your heart this day. Remembering that just about everyone called by God in the Bible makes excuses and is afraid. Let us take some time now to notice where we might be resisting God's call in our lives. If you can identify a specific question or call in your life, then focus on that. If not, focus on the general, in general on the ways in which you might resist God's invitation to fullness of life. What excuses do you find yourself making? What reasons do you give yourself for not doing something? What is getting in the way? Go gently and try to befriend your excuses. Let's take a few moments now to pay attention to the resistances in our heart this day. Now let's take a moment to imagine what God's response might be. Is God whispering something to you like God says to Jeremiah? You might be a boy, but you can do it. Don't be afraid, I will be with you. You don't have to have the right words because I will give them to you. How do you feel about God's response? What might your next step be? You may not hear a response yet. Sometimes these things take time. But let's pause now for a moment to listen together. Thanks for letting this sermon go in a different direction today. Often in worship, we focus on learning about the Bible and thinking about how Bible stories might inform our responses to the world we live in today. And that's a worthwhile thing to do. However, sometimes I think we just have to let the story speak through us and rattle around in us so that we can listen more deeply to our own lives and how Scripture might open us up to new insights about ourselves and what God is doing in our lives. Maybe like Jeremiah, you stand at a crossroads in life and need to hear God's response to your excuses. Or perhaps you relate more to the story of Jesus and the bent over woman. I'm not going to unpack that terrific story much today, but it's a great story to let rattle around in you too, if you are feeling bent over and unable to stand tall in the face of whatever life is throwing at you. It's also fascinating to think about it if you're trying to resist the voices like the synagogue leader who say, "That's not how we do things around here." I love the story so much I couldn't resist reading it even if I wasn't planning to preach on it. And if neither of those stories grabs you, maybe another one will. There's Jacob who runs away, there's Elijah who hides in a cave, there's Mary and Martha who have that dynamic tension in their family. Lazarus is dead, so if you feel dead, there's a story for you. There's also Elijah and the dry bones, which is a great story if you feel dead. So take some time this week to think about what is God doing in your life right now. And whatever it is, I pray for God's blessing for each one of you today and always. Amen. Let's sing about responding to God's call. Each of us have gifts that are needed for the work of God in the world. Let us find freedom beyond our excuses and stand tall as children of God, called, equipped, and sent out to serve in the world as we sing together our song for the dedication of our offering of time, talent, and treasure. Pray together. Caring God, as you receive our offering, remind us how to share your love with the world. Inspire us to seek the needs of our community and to act, that we might lessen the struggle and challenges for each other. Encourage us to use the ways you've blessed our lives, that we might be a blessing for others. And let us continue in prayer. O God, our upholder and our light, illumine the paths before us. Show us the places where we are called to serve in the world. Give us the wisdom and courage we need to embrace life in all its fullness. We pray especially this day for everyone who is standing at a crossroads. For children and youth and adults beginning new educational opportunities. For those grieving the loss of a loved one. For those contemplating career changes and choices. For those adjusting to new realities due to illness or aging. For those starting new relationships or facing changes in their circles of family and friends. For those whose children have grown and the family is adjusting to new patterns of relating. O God, our stronghold and our rock, help us to know that you are with us always through every challenge and change. When life is difficult and we are afraid or feeling overwhelmed, remind us that you are our sure foundation through all the stages of life. We pray especially this day for those who are ill or injured and those who care for them. For those who are dying and those who love them. For those who live in war-torn parts of the world and for those who must cope with violence or the threat of violence in their home or community. For those who wrestle with heavy burdens of prejudice and stigma. For those who are feeling burnt out or overworked. For those who are struggling to meet their basic needs for food, clothing, shelter, and love. For those who don't know where to find meaning anymore. O God, our rock and our light, may our lips sing out your joy, may our liver murmur of your justice all day long. May our lives be redeemed by your love. We ask all this in the name of Jesus, our teacher and guide, as we pray together the words he taught. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our closing hymn is in More Voices 209, Go Make a Difference.
Go make a difference in the world. we are the salt of the earth, called to let the people see the love of God for you and me. We are the light of the world, called to be hid in what we see. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. We are the hands of Christ, reaching out to those in need. The face of God for all to see. We are the spirit of hope, we are the voice of peace. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. So let your love shine on, let it shine for all to see. Go make a difference in the world, and the Spirit of Christ will be with us as we go. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world. Go make a difference, we can make a difference. Go make a difference in the world.
As our worship draws to a close, we extinguish this candle, remembering that we carry the Christ candle with us as we live our daily lives. May its flame burning in us renew our hope and strength and guide us towards fullness of life for all creation, now and forevermore. And loving God, as we go from here this day, give us the courage to step out in faith, to follow your call to us, even if we are uncertain or afraid, trusting that your presence goes with us, and that you will equip us with whatever we need as we go. And may the blessing of God, our sure foundation, of Jesus, the light of the world, and of the Holy Spirit, our inner teacher and guide, strengthen us for the journey, today and always.